high-dose EPA, triglycerides, and general health.
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. Anonymous says, Dr. Rhonda Patrick has recently discussed her supplement regimen on various podcasts in which she takes 2 grams of high EPA pills in the morning and 2 grams of high DHA pills in the evening. She mentioned in a tweet that a high dose fish oil, 4 grams a day, lowered triglyceride levels by 20 to 30% in people with high triglycerides, according to analysis of 17 randomized controlled trials reviewed by the Scientific Advisory Council at the American Heart Association. Could you please comment if you believe this level of fish oil is generally safe for physically active male in his mid-30s? And if not, what do you believe would be a more appropriate level? Thanks, Dr. CMJ. Yeah, I mean, I didn't need the advisory council of the AHA to tell me that. It's definitely the case that high-dose EPA lowers triglyceride levels and in people with high triglycerides, and it does those by interfering with carbohydrate signaling. So carbohydrate signaling, part through glucose itself and part through insulin, increases triglyceride synthesis. And in insulin-resistant people, generally, the average person with insulin resistance has an amplification of that pathway and is actually hypersensitive to it while being resistant to glucose handling part of the pathway. So blood glucose and blood triglycerides increase. And if you take high-dose EPA, you will interfere with the signaling and you will lower the triglycerides. I would regard that as a pharmacological activity of EPA. And I think that's, you know, worthy of consideration as a pharmacological way to lower high triglycerides. But I don't think that has anything whatsoever to do with the nutritional requirement for EPA. And I actually don't think there is a nutritional requirement for EPA. And this gets a little bit complicated because all these fatty acids are interconverted. So there's not a nutritional requirement for DHA either, unless you have very severe impairment in the ability to synthesize it from alpha-linolenic acid. But there's sort of not a nutritional requirement for alpha-linolenic acid if you're eating DHA. And so I think this gets real messy with the terminology. Some people would step in and say that DHA is conditionally essential if you're not getting ALA, or that it, you know, you could also say ALA is conditionally essential if you're not getting DHA. I prefer to think of it as you have a physiological requirement for DHA, you don't have a physiological requirement for EPA, and you have a nutritional requirement for whatever it takes to meet your physiological requirement of DHA. And so the, you know, if you're going to meet the DHA with nutritional dietary DHA, you're probably going to meet that requirement with 250 milligrams of it. Now, things change a little bit for a pregnant woman or a nursing woman, because there are some studies that suggest that 2 grams of omega-3 fatty acids from the sum of EPA and DHA will maximize breast milk DHA content, and that has lasting effects on IQ at 4 years of age. And there is a pretty unique window of opportunity to get fatty acids into the brain in a very efficient manner when during the pregnancy and nursing period, and probably up to the 4 year mark, I'm guessing, but I'm not sure. So apart from that, I think generally an adult DHA nutritional requirement is going to be more than satisfied by 250 milligrams a day of DHA. And EPA, I view more as a pharmacological agent. It's obviously naturally present in a lot of foods that are rich in DHA. I don't think there's anything wrong with getting EPA that comes along with
a daily average 250 milligrams of DHA, but I don't think that the, using EPA to interfere with the normal physiological signaling of carbohydrates, or the normal physiological signaling of prostaglandins, I don't think that's a nutritional thing. I think it's a pharmacological thing. And I think that's best viewed as if you have high triglycerides that don't respond to improving your health and diet in, you know, within the context of normal physiology, then high-dose EPA is a pharmacological option on the table for lowering those triglycerides. And then, of course, there's also some evidence that high-dose EPA is also a pharmacological agent for depression. Outside of that, typical adult dietary requirement more than well met by 250 milligrams of DHA is my opinion. All right, thank you, Anonymous, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ Masterpass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The Masterpass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.